Those people who attach diverse values, also ethical, to the variety of life on the planet may find the below questions irrelevant. But the reality is that much of our decision making is based on assessing relative benefits to various social groups against cost of achieving these benefits. With this in mind, and considering big efforts needed to tackle an accelerating biodiversity loss, as well as other enveloping crises, many decision makers ask two questions. One is just how much biodiversity we, humanity, need to protect to avoid detriment to our own well-being. And the second, what kind of biodiversity do we need to obtain those benefits? Surely we do not need absolutely every species out of about 2 million described so far, and all the intact populations in order to survive. For a researcher, this question would look a bit like this. What level of biodiversity is needed in order to sustain ecosystem functions that provide for human needs, such as growth of usable biomass, crops, timber, or fish stocks, water purification, pollination, and others? Let's imagine this as a simple response curve between the increase of biodiversity, for example, number of species or number of genotypes on x-axis, and the level of ecosystem functioning, say efficiency of pollination or yield, on y-axis. Take a pause now and think what kind of relationship curve you would expect and why. And don't look for a single right answer, because there is none. Research on this has been spanning over 40 years. Well, over 600 experiments have been performed in all types of environments, terrestrial and aquatic, in field and in lab. There is a whole mathematical theory developed around this one question. We know by now that the relationship could look anything like the ones here. We can imagine one study manipulating very low numbers of species, say from 1 to 5. This means that it compares a yield of every single species grown separately to yields of all possible combinations of 2 species out of 5, then combinations of 3 and 4 species, and finally all 5 species grown together. This research finds a linear increase. More species, better function, that is higher yield. Another study may look at higher numbers of species, say from 10 to 15, and finds no dependence. The number of species does not influence the function, that is yield. Yet both fit the same curve and represent the same reality. They are not contradictory as such, because results will depend on the study design. In a famous review from 2012 titled "Biodiversity Loss and Its Impact on Humanity," Professor Cardinale and his colleagues summarized the evidence accumulated by that time as following. In most cases, the relationship would fall into the zone around solid line, while in some cases, a reduction in biodiversity may take the system into either collapse in its performance or greatly improve it, the dot high up. 3 general conclusions came from the synthesis. First, diversity in nature is important for functioning, and its effects are remarkably consistent and positive. Whether we look at species or genotypes or trophic groups, their numbers would most contribute to better functioning. Second, on the other hand, species identity is also important. Recall a negative relationship in the image before or indicated by the upper dot. Can it ever be? Well, of course. Think about a monocrop field that can be as productive as it gets. And why so? Well, because potentially there is always one species or genotype that performs best for any particular function, for example grain yield, in any specific setting, such as climate, soil type, or as long as it has the optimal conditions to function, for example optimal ratios of nutrients, right amount of water, protection from herbivory and competitors. Similarly, One pollinating species could be the best in any particular situation for any particular plant species. Adding more species may actually lessen the performance of the best one through competition. For as long as those optimal conditions are maintained, one species can outperform others. The third key discovery the researchers made was that a saturating curve prevails. That is, positive effects of biodiversity tend to saturate at low levels of diversity. This kind of curve is called redundancy hypothesis. Redundant meaning unnecessary. It seems that decision makers have a point, thinking that there is some level of biodiversity above which the humanity should not be concerned of losing it. However, before we take this for the answer, let's ponder the limitations. Remember, this is what our research tells us. And let's admit that research, no matter how well performed, is always limited. Firstly, most research deals with individual processes or functions and is conducted at a limited number of research sites. The synthesis above discovered that the more functions are included into the same study, the higher diversity is needed for supporting them. Basically, this means that different species are needed for biomass production as compared to water purification or regulation of nutrient cycle. Quite obvious, isn't it? In reality, we rely on multifunctional ecosystems. Yet this is often forgotten in decision making and in managing land. The synthesis also confirmed that the importance of diversity increases with the number of research sites across multiple regions. This is due to a simple fact that different species are best at any given geographical location. The best pollinating species in Finland may not be the same as in Spain. Yet how much research would include research sites in all countries, all biogeographical regions, or over the whole globe? Well, secondly, most research focuses on specific aspects of diversity, mostly species or genotypes or functional groups. Yet each of these is important, and if studied simultaneously, diversity's contribution to the function increases. For example, the diversity across several trophic groups, from primary producers to decomposers, has a considerable effect on stability of many ecosystem functions. It is well known that a deletion of just one trophic layer, for example, top predators, can drastically change the whole biome. Finally, the longer an experiment runs, the more pronounced the need for diversity is. In other words, diversity provides stability of functioning over time. Let's look at this a little closer. As the saying goes, the only permanent feature of the world is change. Change of prevailing conditions happens through a day, year, across years, centuries, and millennia. And at every particular combination of conditions, a different species is likely to carry out a certain function best. The theory and numerous empirical examples confirm more diverse systems have a greater probability than less diverse systems of containing species that are suited to the changed prevailing conditions. You have two ecosystems, one is species rich and one is species poor. There is a certain functions that they perform, for example, yield or pollination. And there is a stressor, a change that comes to the conditions, for example, drought or cold spell. A more biodiverse ecosystem then can decline in its functioning because of the stressor, and then it regains its functioning to the pre-stressor level. But in a poor species system, the decline in the function drops much further, and then it is much likelier that it will never regain its functioning. And this is because a very needed species was missing in that poor species system. So by chance, more diverse biological systems should better withstand changes in environmental conditions through time. This property is called resilience. The theoretical framework overall is called the insurance hypothesis or portfolio effect. This is because it resembles an approach to investing in shares from several companies, ensuring that at least some of them bring profit by chance, or not to keep all your eggs in one bucket. Not relying on one or a few number of species to carry out their work for us. We cannot predict with high certainty what climatic conditions might be at any given location in, say, 200 years, and therefore what species will be needed to perform those important functions. We should therefore remember also that having a specific species in a locality is not sufficient. A whole network of interactions with other species in the community should also work for that species to function. For example, all symbiotic relationship must be present, or parasites should not be too numerous, etc. No species functions in its isolation. There are virtually hundreds of real-life examples illustrating all the above. They lead us to conclude that, firstly, it is unlikely that all the existing diversity of species and genotypes is necessary for the biosphere functioning. There is a redundant or unnecessary level of diversity. Yet this very redundancy is an insurance into future capacity of ecosystems to function despite changes. Secondly, it is highly improbable that we can ever obtain definite answers to the questions we posed in the beginning: how much biodiversity we need and what kind of biodiversity. For this, we would need to know precisely the functioning of all species in combinations of all conditions and their ecological interactions for all localities. Also, to be able to predict the long-term environmental changes and our future needs. In the meanwhile, it is reasonable to put efforts into preserving as much of the richness of this planet's life as only possible. At the very least, to ensure our own existence.